And we're live. Welcome to the Lovecraft eZine videocast slash podcast. Today is January the 17th, 2016. And today's guest is, put him on the screen here, author Robert Levy. Am I saying your last name right, Levy?
Levy. Yes, perfect. Okay. I'm impressed.
Awesome. And Robert is the author of this book here, The Glittering World.
That's it. You have it.
Yeah, well, a nice person sent it to me, and so this particular copy is actually going to be worth a lot of money. It probably already is. Worth
Today is the day.
Yeah, and actually I have it in Kindle format as well, because if I remember right, Amazon did that $1.99 sale a couple of days, a few months back, so.
Yeah, and in case you don't know, that is like, you know, in my case, it was Christmas in August, which is, they actually, so they do a Kindle Daily deal.
Yeah.
You have probably heard of it, but what I didn't know about it is that they mark your book down to $1.99, and Amazon subsidizes the publisher's loss on it, so you get your full royalty rate on this incredibly cheap version of your book that is really heavily publicized through Amazon's channels, and it's like a sales bonanza. If anyone can figure out how to get their work into this thing, I highly recommend it.
I actually did not know that, and a couple of times I've just reduced the price on certain books or magazine issues of Lovecraft eZine. But no, I did not know that you got the full royalties, so yeah. I'm going to have to get in that program.
My publisher did that and never told me. I found out like halfway through.
There's that.
Like, Pete, did you know your book was $1.99 today? No.
Yeah. Yeah. It's nice to know in advance.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to correct my mistake, first of all, and then we'll talk to Robert here from last week. I forgot to give the giveaway instructions at the end or middle of the show. So we're going to give away those three books, plus Matt's given away a copy of The Glittering World. Thank you, Matt, since we're talking to the guy who wrote it. And we'll also give away, and I think you were doing all three of these, Pete, Crypt of Cthulhu, H.P. Lovecraft's Nightmare Country, and what was the other one? Oh, Lurking Chronology. Yeah, I've heard of that book. So, by Pete Rolick. So, we'll give all four of those away today, and I'll draw for those next weekend. So, anyone who listens to the show this week, you can get in on those, on that drawing. So, anyway, Robert, thanks for coming on the show. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So, you wrote a book called The Glittering World. And I finished it this weekend. It's been on the top of my list for a while, and I thought, I better get this finished since I'm going to have the guy on the show. And loved it. And as I wrote in my description for the show today, it kind of defies description somewhat. I think your publisher marketed it as a supernatural thriller, didn't they?
Yep, but that was the kind of compromise marketing term. I think it was, for me, I like things that go through a lot of different genres, and it's fun as a writer, and it keeps your interest going, especially at a novel length, but it can be a kind of marketing publicity issue. But it's also the kind of thing I like to read. I like to read things that are a mix of horror and fantasy and, you know, noir, thriller. It's just when it comes to slotting it for, you know, publication, it can be a little tricky.
Yeah, I do too. I mean, you could call it horror, you could call it weird fiction. There's cosmic horror in there as well. Can you talk a little bit, just very mild spoilers. I listened to the show that you did with Scott a while back on The Outer Dark, and probably that level of spoiler is appropriate. Just not to give away anything, but can you talk a little bit about the plot of the book for those who have not read it yet?
Sure. The basic premise is that it's about four New Yorkers who travel to remote Cape Breton, Nova Scotia, in eastern Canada, a maritime province, on vacation, and all the sort of wondrous, horrifying things that happen to them there. One of the characters is there to sell on a house that his grandmother left him in her will, and when he's there, he discovers he is not who he thought he was, and in fact, he is not human at all. And the plot kind of spins out from there, and it's told from four points of view of the four vacationers, but it doesn't really alternate so much as have the baton passed. Each quarter of the novel switches over to the next character, which. Much like mixing genres, definitely saved my interest at a novel length because I got to see the world through all these different characters, but also presented its own challenges as well.
Yeah, you mentioned the character who finds out that he's not who he thinks he is. I think it was Livia Llewellyn, who I believe you know.
Sure.
We were talking about the definition of weird fiction one time on this show. It's been a while back, and I said something along the lines of things are not as you think they are. And she said, and I would add to that, and you are not who you think you are either, which what you just said reminded me of that. So
that's interesting. You know, it's funny. I was at a panel at ReaderCon a couple years ago, and the panel was, is it horror or is it dark fantasy? Which is something that, you know, on the one hand, I think talking about genre can be a lot of BS. At the same time, I also find it an interesting subject. I wish it didn't exist, but since it does, I find it fascinating. And one of the panelists, I think it was Jean Savalos. I'm not sure if that's how you pronounce her name, but she said, "Dark fantasy is from the monster's point of view." And I thought that was so interesting, and it was especially an interesting distinction in terms of this particular novel, The Glittering World, because, as you find out, one of the points of view is, in fact, from this, monster. Right. And I like that. I don't know if it holds altogether, but I thought it was an interesting distinction.
I think I feel much the same way you do. If people try to pin down what a book should be, or let's say what weird fiction should be, or what horror should be, I find myself getting irritated. But at the same time, having studied marketing and promotion for over two decades, it fascinates me from that standpoint, because you have to have a starting point to hook the reader on the book, so something they can relate to, perhaps.
Absolutely, and you know, a lot of readers really it's so fun to be surprised, but at the same time, people don't want to be too surprised, it's a fine line. It's kind of a dance for any author to kind of satisfy both of those needs, and you find that in publishing in general, certainly in mainstream publishing, where people say, I want something new, I want something new, I want something new, and then you give them something new, and they're like, I don't know what to do with this.
Yeah.
Which is why so much great horror and weird fiction is coming out of small presses, because they're willing to take those chances.
Yes, but you, however, have what I would definitely personally call weird fiction, a weird fiction novel published by Simon & Schuster, who are not small press.
No, I snuck it by them.
You forgot to tell them it was weird fiction so that they would reject it, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please do.
Where are you from? Are you from Cape Breton? Why did you choose this place? Had you visited it?
Yeah, it's...
The nature of the island seems to play a big role.
Definitely, it's kind of, I haven't been there in a while, but I spent a number of summers going up there with friends, and it kind of became my magical special place. And once I had kids, it's a haul to get up there. It takes at least half a day. You have to fly into Halifax and drive for about 4 hours, and certainly to the place where we used to go. And since I had kids, I wasn't able to go up there anymore, and it was kind of my way of returning there. I hope to go again soon, maybe even as soon as this year, since my kids are a little older. But it was kind of my fun way of going on vacation without leaving the house. And so much of the story is built around the flora and fauna of the land, and I had to do a lot of research on that I had no idea about, and the native people and the native folklore as well. So I kind of tried to build this whole story out of that land, which is really integral to the actual plot.
Yeah, to build on Matt's question there, can you talk a little bit about that, or as much as you want about that, the folklore and the mythology behind the book? Did that come from Nova Scotia as well?
It did. It's funny. A lot of the book has been categorized as a dark fairy tale, and in some ways quite literally. It's partially about what people mean when they describe fairies in whatever culture. There are legends of little people and other people in just about every culture and time. It's really prevalent, and something happened particularly in the 70s, where people used to have a very strong belief in fairies. A lot of people still do, and a lot of cultures have their own take on it. But in the 70s, alien abduction mythology became really prevalent. And something that's always interested me is that a lot of the way that people talk about fairies and a lot of which is being taken away by the fairies, which is abduction, tracks so closely to aliens. And I started taking a look at, well, what are fairies really? What are people talking about when they're talking about fairies? What are people talking about when they're talking about aliens and being abducted? Mm-hmm. And that was part of how the story, you know, grew out of those similar beliefs. And the thing that's interesting about Cape Breton is you have this native people, the Mi'kmaq, and then you have all of these interesting immigration patterns, particularly ones from Scotland and Ireland that brought their own fairy faiths to this land that already had this belief system in place, and how they merged in the way that the culture merged at large.
Yeah, have you seen a film called, and it was based on a short story by John Connolly?
I knew you were going to bring this up.
Did you?
Because I think one of the reasons you like this, Mike, is because this is an expand. In many ways, this echoes what Connolly did in his short story, The New Daughter. In that the fairies, the underground folk, whatever you want to call them, they're both wondrous and horrible. It's an amazing world, but it's also terrifying.
Right.
If you're not prepped for it, it can be a real mental mindfuck. And it even echoes in with the whole concept that they're a little bit insectile, a little bit reptilian. They're not just fairies. They're something else completely. And as soon as I saw that you liked this, I knew why, Mike. Because I know you like that book, that story and that movie, and this seems to be a more, in many ways, and I'm not saying it's derivative, I'm just saying that in many ways it's an exploration of that same kind of world.
Which is the movie called The New Daughter as well?
It is, yeah.
I'm shocked I have not heard of this, because I really thought I knew I had covered all my bases. But
well, in particular, there's a line in your book where it talks about, I'm not going to quote this exactly, but that they can't reproduce among themselves. They have to crossbreed or whatever. And that occurs in The New Daughter as well. And I liked the short story a lot, and I think, Pete, after I watched the movie, I liked the movie even better. It's one of those few films that expound on a short story and do a better job, I think. I don't know if better is the right word, but they're both very, very good. But yeah, definitely check it out.
What's that?
It has Kevin Costner in it.
Yeah. Well, it's a perfect Kevin Costner role. He's divorced, he has a child he can't communicate with, and he's facing an emotional crisis, which means he can't express his emotions. So it's like tailor-made for him.
Oh my gosh, and the girl who played Dagny Taggart in Atlas Shrugged Part 2. Wow, okay. All right. Awesome. Okay, sorry. I just got really excited about that. Never mind.
No, jump in anytime. So he's a perfect Pa Kent, in other words, is what you're saying.
Robert, were you influenced by Arthur Macken?
I mean, I've read stuff of his. Maybe indirectly. My biggest direct influences, to the point where I was, very conscious about not ripping them off, were Elizabeth Hand and Laird Barron. I read a lot of Laird's short stories that his subterranean works while I was writing this to be inspired. And I read a lot of Elizabeth Hand's stories and novels that were about these kind of intentional communities, communes, bordering on possible sects and cults, to sort of, kind of parse out this world that I was building. Those were my two conscious ones. I had a lot of unconscious ones. One of whom was definitely Lovecraft, and to my touchstone for creating this mythology of the other kind, as they're called, these sort of unknowable creatures, was Lovecraft, that I never wanted them to be completely known, which is something that I think everyone has found particularly compelling about Lovecraft's work, and that's something I always really admired in Caitlin Kiernan's work as well, that she never really shows you what you're interfacing with. It's just that peek behind the curtain.
Which... Yeah, and if I can say, I thought you did that really, really well, because as I was reading the book, thinking how much I loved reading it, how much I was loving the story, I thought to myself, I hope he doesn't reveal too much about these beings, leaves that mystery there, because it's more horrifying, it's more fascinating, and that's exactly what you did. You revealed just enough to keep us fascinated. So,
thanks. It's a balancing act, and you're never going to please everyone. You're always going to have people who think you haven't told enough, or you've told too little, so you got to just kind of do what you think is right.
Yeah, I did some highlighting. There's something this is a quote from the book, I'm sorry. They are something you can't perceive exactly, like they weren't made to be seen with human eyes. I could only catch parts of them, glimpses of them, the parts they allowed me to access. So...
Early on, we were talking about how, the definition of the weird being things are not how you are, how you think they are, and Liv's comment that you are not how you think they are. But one of the things that struck me in this book is that everyone in the book is not how you think they are, and for people who are going on vacation together, who are lifelong friends, they really don't know each other at all. And they know, in many ways, this is like late 80s, early 90s road trip film.
Uh-huh.
It's like The Big Chill, where you sit down and, we're going to all be friends. And then you end up hating each other. And then you end up being better friends at the end. But it's painful to go through. These people, have portrayed themselves as they want to be, and they perceive each other as they would like to perceive each other, but they've missed out on some obvious clues, particularly when it comes to Gabe. Gabe has done a really great job of hiding who he really is, and nobody's noticed.
Yeah, it is sort of fun to have him as the last point of view character, because he's the only one that's in every single part of the story, and you finally find out who he is. And you know, it's true. They're all hiding. And I mean, we do a lot of that in life. And they do a lot of that in this book. Husbands and wives hide from each other. Friends hide from each other. And you know, for a variety of reasons. And
And Gabe also hides from himself.
Oh yeah, big time. As does Blue, and
You know, the other thing it struck me about Gabe, when we got to his part, I thought, you know, this is a book with, you could say, four protagonists, really. Whereas most books, there's one main character, for lack of a better term. It almost seemed to me, if you had to pick whose story this really was, if you had to, I don't think you should, but if you had to, it would be Gabe.
Probably. I mean, just he is definitely the most, he's definitely the most present in all four parts, and then second is Blue. There was a lot of talk about whether to put a table of contents in the beginning that told you, which a lot of people, especially on Kindle, you skip right over if you start on the first, you know, page they send you to, but whether to say on the table of contents that it switches, you know, to have their names and to alert the reader that it switches points of view.
Right.
And, you know, it was decided to do that because it was felt to be too, you know, it might pull the, you know, rug out from readers too much, but there is this really wonderful, it sort of goes back to that question of how much to surprise the reader in whatever you're doing. I think there's sort of this wonderful thrill when I read something that does something like that. The first time I had heard of that ever being done was the movie Psycho, where Janet Leigh was really prominently featured on all the posters, and you start with her, and you're following her journey, and then half an hour into the movie is the shower scene, and apparently people freaked out when this happened.
The studio freaked out.
Yeah, I bet. you know, you can't beat that. That feeling where anything can happen after that. If your protagonist dies, you know, a quarter of the way into the movie or a third of the way, you know, all bets are off.
Yeah, you know, and I had that exact feeling after part one ended with Blue, because I thought, what the hell? What you know, what's going to happen now? You know, it could go anywhere.
That's good. And as you say, the table of contents gives you a clue that, you know, there's going to be a reformation, a return, at least partially.
Yeah, can always tell if someone's read the table of contents or not, because sometimes people will be like, it's like page 92 or 93, I know, because people text me and they're like, I just got to this page, and what the fuck? And I'm like, just, yeah, sorry.
And it struck me, too, that if you wanted to write it, just if this was a short story, it could very easily have ended with part one. You didn't need to add to it if it was a short story. I'm trying to think of this. This is not a negative comment at all. It's a positive comment. But the three sections that follow build on it beautifully. And so I thought, well, that's kind of the end of the story for Blue, but it just would not have been. I mean, the other three sections were great. It struck me that could have been a short story all by itself with Blue. So,
I mean, you know, and it's this. Us talking about this for people watching, it's not as much of a spoiler as you think it is. There's no one dies on that page.
Just, no.
And we're talking about something else altogether.
Kylo Ren is Han's son.
Nevertheless, and even though Blue does not die at the end of his part, the MO while writing that first part was that I was writing it as the last week of his life, even though it's not. That was my writerly MO, because in many ways it is, and in many ways it isn't. But that's how I tried to write it, which is why there is something about the first part that definitely has this sense of completion. Just like you could end Psycho after the shower scene.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think I put that very well at all, but that's
No. I think you did perfectly. It's self-contained.
Yeah.
I think you could say that about the end of any of the four parts. You could have ended it after, you know, there are events that serve as, we could end it here, but I want to tell the rest of the story from somebody else's point of view. Okay, then when we can end it, you know, there's three good spots to end it. You chose to do four, and I think all four work really well.
Cool. Thanks. I don't think I was entirely successful, but one of the things that I really try to avoid in my work is to make heroes and villains. So it was a really, to get to tell all four characters POVs was a really great chance to give everyone a fair shake and to see, to start in Blue's point of view and see, for example, how he sees Jason, and to have Jason be somewhat two-dimensional in Blue's part, and then to go right into his perspective and have him see Blue, I thought, you know, was really a unique opportunity, as long as I could hold people's hands through the whole experience. But again, there's a big trade-off, and I always knew that there would be people who would be like, well, I wanted more Blue, and, you know, I wanted more of this and more of that. Well, that's not this book. Sorry.
Well, you know, it's funny because you talk about Jason as being two-dimensional, and even when you're talking from his point of view, he sees Blue as this huge, dominating personality that in whose light of he is just a shadow. So he himself sees himself as a two-dimensional character. But the way you write him is obviously that he's not a two-dimensional character. He's, of all the characters that we explore, I think his is the most developed and damaged, because he's desperately trying to deal with a whole conflicting range of emotions. Including, I should just leave.
Yeah, his reality is very carefully constructed.
Yeah, he seems like, from Blue's perspective, you said two-dimensional. I when I was reading it, I thought, Blue thinks this guy's really got it together, you know. He's 10 years older than him, and so forth. And then, when you get to Jason's section, you're like, he doesn't have anything together. This guy's all fucked up, you know.
Yeah. They're all fucked up.
Yeah, that's true. All four of them are. Yeah.
Molly, you gotta say something.
Molly, jump in anytime.
Actually, I did have another question. Robert, so can you talk about your relationship with New York? Because it seems to figure in deeply with a lot of your writing, and like, have you lived there your whole life? Like, what is it about it that compels you to write about it so often, and like, do you find it endlessly fruitful? Like, what is it? Is it because you've lived here your whole life? Like, what's the deal?
Yeah, well, I have lived here my whole life. Ironically, you know, I thought I was getting away from it, right, setting an entire novel in Cape Breton. but you know, wherever you go, there you are.
Yeah.
And this, the book is, it's about four New Yorkers, and they take a lot of New York with them. As I think a lot of us do.
Oh, do you think so? South Face?
Yeah, you know, I wouldn't know anything about that, but New York is a very, you know, it's a very rarefied environment in a lot of ways, and I think that when you go other places, I mean, this could be true of anywhere, but it's really true, you know, to paraphrase Dangerous Liaisons, you know, it's what's true of most places is doubly so of New York. And, you know, it's you do land up feeling like an alien sometimes when you go other places, and you're like, this is how I'm supposed to behave in this new environment, you know? Whereas in New York, it's just like, go, 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 you know? You're like, I'm relaxing now.
Are you in Manhattan or another borough?
I'm in Brooklyn, where I've been pretty much my whole life.
Well, I was born in Brooklyn.
Oh, what part?
Wherever 345 Clinton Avenue is.
Oh, very nice.
That was my old address, in case anyway, so I don't remember where Clinton Avenue is.
I am from Clinton Street, which is also the street where Lovecraft used to live, which I found out surprisingly late in life, that we lived on the same block, basically.
So you're in Red Hook.
What was then called South Brooklyn, and now it's officially Brooklyn Heights, which is kind of the poshest part of Brooklyn. But then, you know, there was no posh part of Brooklyn back in Lovecraft's day. Nor particularly when I was growing up here in the 70s.
I have a question about the time period that the book is set in, because you're not real explicit, but they talk about 9/11 and that it happened 5 years previously. And I wondered if there's a reason why you're setting it, why you set it in 2006, because obviously you just wrote it a year or two ago, or somewhere around there.
So. Uh-huh. Well, that was when I used to go up to Cape Breton.
Okay.
So and that was when I turned 30. So, which is what Blue has just turned, and there's an astrological term called the Saturn return. I don't know if you know what it is, but it's kind of where you start, you sort of put away your you maybe put away your sort of childish dreams, or you kind of double down on them. It's kind of like where you leave your childhood behind, and it's sort of your early midlife crisis, your Saturn return, and it was a time in my life that I associated with Cape Breton, and for the characters, it was where, you know, particularly Blue and Elisa, as the 30-year-olds, really had to sort of examine where they were going, and I always sort of find that as an interesting time in one's life. A lot of people write about teenagers, both whether they're writing young adult or not, and I find that really true in genre fiction today. I read endless particularly fantasy stories about teenagers. That's a real time of heightened emotion, and everything's really dramatic and important, and you make a lot of life choices. But I find that Saturn return time, that 30-year-old time, to be an even more interesting time, because your life is not all in front of you anymore. You've moved into adulthood, and it's a time of reckoning and power or powerlessness, depending on where you are in your life.
Okay, now I have the human interest questions. Just looking behind you on the wall, I see two Ouija boards, and I see a giant palm. And I was wondering maybe if you could talk about the decor.
I like mystical stuff. I'm fascinated by spiritualism, and it's funny, I don't believe in astrology. I'm interested I studied psychology quite seriously, and psychoanalysis in particular is a really interesting lens through which to view the world. And I think of astrology as being one of these lenses. Tarot cards is another. I find these structures just a really fascinating way to view life experience. And even though I don't really believe in any of them, I'm sort of endlessly fascinated by these systems, so that's probably why I have this stuff up. You shouldn't see the rest of the room. It's, like, even worse.
Joe, do you have some questions for Robert? Maybe Joe might be frozen. I don't know. There he is.
No, I just was muted because I didn't want to make noise.
No, yeah.
Not a lot. Mostly I'm curious as to what he's working on.
I'm working on a few different things. I'm working on a couple short stories for possibly some people on this pop show.
I have my fingers crossed, and I'm very aware of one little thing, but just in general, other than the things after you're done with that particular story is what I'm curious about.
I've moved really heavily into working in television and film lately. I'm working on a couple of different books, a young adult book and an adult book. But right now, primarily, I just wrote my first television pilot. That just went out. I just finished a screenplay that
can
I'm shopping.
Tell something about those?
What's that?
Is it all hush-hush, or can you tell us a little bit about them? You can trust us.
The television pilot is, it's called Nothing Dies Forever, and it's related to a book project that I've been working on that Molly has read part of. It's quite Lovecraftian, actually, and it's a lot about, it takes place in Brooklyn, and it's spun out of my own relationship with Lovecraft, actually, and having lived in this place that he used to live and had this entirely different experience of. And the screenplay is something else entirely that I probably shouldn't talk about. But
are we going to see all that on TV, or I don't know how that works. Is there a big process where it may or may not get greenlit?
For the pilot?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, there's a huge process. I mean, right now it's gone out to, like, a small handful of people. I have a manager in L.A. that I work with, it's a long road, but so far, so good. So,
has there been any interest in the glittering world?
Yeah, it's not
the film community?
I always thought that it would be perfect for film, but my manager is shopping.
Well.
Yeah, my manager's actually shopping it for TV. It turns out the TV is where all the action is right now, and
willing to take more chances.
Much more willing, and especially
these days.
Studio, you know, certainly large studios. They make 10 to 12 movies a year, and 10 of them are Transformers 5, you know?
Yeah.
So if you want to see something get made right now, move into television. And it's, you know, it probably won't last forever, but that's where, you know, that's where the heat is.
You have so many venues, like Netflix has original series, Amazon now has original series.
Exactly.
Sci-fi is putting out lots of new shows, like they just did a Shannara adaptation, an adaptation of The Expanse. I think the success of Game of Thrones has really stimulated people willing to take a risk on the fantastic.
And Showtime with Penny Dreadful.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is great. I love Penny Dreadful. But the there's a problem that's happening. You know, they've really started to talk about this glut of television. And one of the big problems with it is because of Netflix and, you know, these other streaming services like Amazon, is that your new shows now compete with old television shows that have left the air and are complete, and you know that they're all good, like The Wire. So if you've never seen The Wire, you have 100 television episodes or what have you waiting for you that you know are good, that end in a satisfying manner, and why would you take a chance on a new show when you can just go watch this old show that you've heard so much about? So it's getting really interesting. There's a lot out there.
But there's also DVRs, there's CDs, they're sitting there. It means, like, what it says to me is, oh, when I'm done with that one, what's my next thing? It's like, I'd love to see something more come out that's more urban fantasy, not in that genre kind of thing.
Me too, for sure.
Yeah, in some capacity, these things have replaced Blockbuster, where you'd go in on Saturday, you know, 4 o'clock, and you'd walk around and go, yeah, let's rent this, or let's rent this and that. So there they are.
We were out yesterday talking about the fact that you don't see a video store much anymore. You're right.
The only problem I have is that, you know, the internet and streaming services were supposed to make everything available to everybody. And instead what's happened is it's factionalized. You can't get what Amazon's producing on Netflix. You can't get what Netflix producing on Amazon. HBO is not talking to Netflix. Showtime's not talking to Amazon.
You know, well, actually, I can give you the perfect formula, okay? And you can cut cable. Here's the perfect formula. Amazon Prime, Netflix, and Hulu. And you're good.
So. You gotta get an HBO now. I don't know.
Yeah, except for there are people who live in Europe.
Yeah,
that is true. I heard that.
It's there not all available to us.
I hear they live in Australia too. Just a rumor I heard.
Oh, those are all descended from prisoners. We don't have to worry about that.
Well, I do that, but then I don't get my soccer channels.
Yeah, and how are you gonna watch the Great British Bake Off if you only have those things? Because they only have one season on Netflix or Amazon Prime.
We need some more of that.
We really do.
I'm upset.
Well, I'll tell you what, my wife has been watching all 12 or 13 seasons of Hell's Kitchen on Hulu.
Oh, see, Hell's Kitchen is mean. The Great British Bake Off is collaborative. They help each other. It's the nicest reality show of all time.
It really is.
I had a question for Robert.
Since he's on the show.
The title of your pilot and the fact that you're in New York, that you was it Nothing Dies Forever? Or
yep.
That sounds like something that could have been written by a fellow Lovecraftian New Yorker, C.J. Henderson. Did you know him?
No. Tell me more.
Well, he, I think he lived in Brooklyn.
All the best ones do.
And he wrote a detective series about a guy, what's his name?
Teddy London.
Teddy London, that's right. And all the books had the title Thing in them. So it was Some Things Never Die and whatever, and it was, and they were all set in New York City.
Yeah. It was basically, and then, another coincidence, Cape Breton
is
not that far from where the other Lovecraftian writer, William Michael, lives. He lives in Catalina, Newfoundland.
Oh, okay.
So it's interesting, you know, and I didn't realize that until like 20 minutes ago. Actually, the funny thing is that once you get past like the first 15 pages, you never really mention again where they're at. I had to go back and check, you know, are they in the Pacific Northwest? Or are they, you know, I completely lost track of where they were because it really didn't matter. They were just isolated.
They're in this very isolated community.
Yeah.
It's this sort of sui generis place in this, you know, sort of magical pocket. Right. They sort of slip out of time. It's the place is described by one of the old timers as fairy touched, and that's, you know, that turns out to be more true than he intended. But the real Cape Breton-ness of it is definitely for me in this in the creatures that you meet sooner than you think.
I just looked at the message board, and Don Lee says, off the subject, but tell Molly Tanzer that, drum roll.
Okay.
Molly's looking at me like, oh, God, what now?
Oh,
Pretty Mouth is my favorite book right now.
Ah. Oh,
that's so sweet. Thanks, Don Lee. Aw.
So.
That's so sweet. Oh my gosh. Back to Robert. Sorry.
I loved Pretty Mouth. I'll agree with Dawn.
Aw, you guys know. I mean, don't stop. Don't ever stop. But
I don't know.
Yeah, it was all right. I'm kidding.
He's old now.
I think I had three drinks in me when I finally pulled the bag out and said, Molly, would you sign this stack of books
for
me?
That was a weird night. That was a weird night, yeah.
How weird. What? Never mind.
Well, remember everybody was wearing those tinfoil hats?
Oh, God. Oh, my God. I forgot about that.
Okay, wait, where were you?
We were in Wellington, Florida, which is where my husband's grandmother lived, and I don't know what cosmic event was happening, but something that concerned people cosmically was going on. I don't know if it's a meteor shower or like it wasn't. I have no idea, but there was something going on where people were like, "Oh my god!" Like something cosmic will happen, and so all these drunk people were at this weird beer bar wearing tinfoil hats and getting really trashed.
Yeah, I remember that. And then there were women in they were doing like some cocktail giveaway.
I don't know what it was happening, honestly.
It was a cigar bar, but yeah, and yeah, it was just weird.
It was World of Beer in Wellington, Florida. It wasn't. Yeah. Yeah, maybe you can smoke there. I don't know. I can't remember what you can do in Florida, honestly. But
well, they had that whole outside area where you could smoke, and I thought they were doing like a cigar bar promotion.
It was a weird night.
It was a weird night.
Yeah. I didn't mean to punk you with that beer either. I didn't know that 10% Yeti was going to just be like, woo!
Oh, yeah. No, if I don't eat while I'm drinking, I'm a real lightweight.
It happens to the best of us.
Yeah.
Listening to the two of you talk, this is like when you read that Lovecraft story and there's some crazy reference that you don't know.
I really can't remember what cosmic event it was. I really have no idea, but it was something that was concerning people who don't understand a lot about science.
Right.
And so it was like, oh my god, aliens or something, and they're just a lot of headgear.
Maybe it was a comet.
It might have been a comet.
But you can't remember, so it must have been a good...
No, because it was, I think for Molly and I, it was just like, yeah, that shit happens.
Yeah.
Anything can happen in Florida. Let's face
Anything
it.
Can happen in Florida. It is true.
Yeah.
And Wellington, Florida is also a weird part of Florida, so...
Yeah. Yeah. Thank God I don't live there.
So, Robert, you said you actually did have Lovecraftian themes in mind when you wrote The Glittering World. That came through, definitely, especially this quote I'm about to read, where one character says to another, "The thing about the other kind, though, they don't care about us, they can't care about us. I get that now. The way that we see ants, that's how they see us, something to study maybe, but not much more." Can you talk a little bit more about the Lovecraftian influence of the book?
Sure. It's one of the characters is an entomologist, which is, building off, there's a very heavy insectile theme that runs throughout the book.
Yeah.
And insects are the third ingredient of aliens and fairies that make up, this kind of creature that inhabits the land, and he's this kind of very archetypal Lovecraftian protagonist who's very professorial and gets in over his head, and it's ambiguous how much he does. This is not one of the four protagonists. This is a secondary character, but a very critical one, and it's. For me, that is one of the things that is attractive about Lovecraft and his fiction is that the concept of cosmic horror, that we are insignificant, which I it's funny, I've noticed a lot of people who have anxiety or depression find this a very comforting thought, that we're completely insignificant, and that's something that people have told me throughout the years, and that's I'm not of that ilk, but a lot of people find that very comforting. I find it kind of horrifying that we are but insects to a larger god figure or monster or alien, where we're nothing. And I think that's something that obviously infuses a lot of Lovecraft's fiction. Is something that I was playing with in the novel from various perspectives.
Could you talk about the changeling theme?
Yeah. I'm sorry?
Could you talk about the changeling theme in your book?
Sure, which is, obviously something that's very critical not only to the book, but is a big part of fairy mythology, is the concept of the changeling, which is, it's It's actually something I probably learned what a changeling was through reading young adult fiction, actually. I was a fan of Holly Black's, and she wrote a book called Tithe, and I think that was the first actual changeling story I had heard. Lots of people here have heard them at much younger ages. It was sort of a new idea to me that fascinated me. It's a very good fit for young adult works because it... So in case people don't know, a changeling is a fairy creature that's been swapped out for a human child. And this, in a way, it's a good fit for young adult fiction because it appeals to one's sense that their parents aren't really their own, which is a wonderful thought when you're a child and you hate your parents because they won't let you do what you want. But in a broader sense, the idea of the changeling is a very dark one that goes back particularly to Irish and Scottish and British fairy lore and was a way to explain away Down syndrome and children that were born deformed or stillborns even, this isn't really your baby, this is the fairy swapped it out. SIDS, crib deaths, and it was a religious way almost because fairy faith is very much tied into Christianity. They are complementary. A way to distance yourself from something that is completely traumatic, like the death of a young child. So it has this really dark past, and it's a fascinating subject, and it obviously died off a lot, but people have believed in changelings as recently as the 50s, and people just don't. So I think people still do and don't talk about it.
Regarding the pointlessness or insignificance of humans, you're definitely right. Some people find that comforting, and some people find it fascinating. And it's interesting that they do feel they're of two minds about it. I'm of the former. If I feel like everything I'm doing is pointless, I just remind myself that yes, that's actually true. So don't worry about it.
Good advice.
So you also talked a little bit in the book, and I don't want to give away too much about the book, but I think one of the characters described the other kind as sort of a shadow, if I remember that right, or it looked like a shadow, kind of a two-dimensional, or pardon me, a three-dimensional shadow of some sort. It made me think of the Legends of the Shadow People. I don't know if you've heard about them at all.
I haven't.
Well, I don't think I'm the best source. I think it's just an old myth about these beings that come when, the lights get down low, and maybe it's just another version of the fairy myth. Who knows? So, but anyway, Joe, do you have any more questions for anyone? Yeah.
I was just to say, there's a lot of books about living shadows, like A Merritt's Creek Shadow Creep, and Jack Mann's The Maker of Shadows, which deal with old legends about living shadows.
There was a very scary old-time radio show episode of The Hall of Fantasy from the early 50s called The Shadow People. And it's one of the more effective old-time radio shows out there, episodes out there. So if you get a chance, listen to that. That's pretty good.
Was that the one that hooked in the hall up?
No. That was Mystery Theater, I believe.
Yeah. They did something with shadow people in the hall.
Oh, okay. No, this was... I don't want to give away any of it, but it's really, really good. So...
Is it M.R. James who has the story about the bed next to his with the sheets that come alive?
I don't know, but I do know I saw that in Doctor Who.
Oh yeah,
that I think that is somewhere in M.R. James.
That reminds me of that, where if you could, where you can like throw a sheet over something and see it. I always sort of loved that concept.
Well, my wife and I don't really know what to think of this, but I'd say about 17 or 18 years ago, we were driving on a lonely country road late at night, and I mean, the middle of nowhere, just going back home. I think it was from someone's wedding. And just in front of the road, from the left to the right, just very, very quickly, it almost looked like this man-shaped, two-dimensional, if you can imagine it, standing straight up, shadow ran from the left to the right of the road very, very quickly. And if I had been alone in the car, I would have thought, well, I'm tired, it's just my imagination. But Danielle saw the exact same thing. So I've never been able to figure it out.
That was in Iowa, right?
That was in Iowa, yeah.
So. He who walks behind the rose.
Sounds like you saw a ghost, I'm just saying.
Hey, I'm not saying it was a ghost, but it was probably a ghost.
It might have been.
Hey, Molly. What did you want to talk about what you saw on the beach?
I was thinking about it, but okay, so I saw a ghost recently, and it kind of disturbed me because I don't believe in ghosts. But I totally had a supernatural experience when I was hanging out with Robert in South Carolina last September?
Yeah.
I think it was September. Mm-hmm. I was out walking on the beach late at night, and there was this horrible apparition. I honestly don't know how to describe it other than that. It was raining and it was lightning and it was totally dark out on the beach. And I saw it and it was coming at me from the other direction. I was walking and it was sort of anyway. And I got really freaked out. I was like, it's just a guy in a raincoat. It's not a big deal. Like obviously it's not a ghost. Ghosts aren't real. But then the lightning flared and it disappeared. And when the darkness came back up again, it was there again. And it kept sort of walking at me, and every time there was light upon it, it disappeared, and then it was present when it was completely dark out, and it was just starlight, and really freaking out, because at some point I had to turn around, and it was still there, because I walked beyond it after it passed me to see if it would, I don't know, take me somewhere horrible, but it didn't, and then when I turned around, it was still there, and eventually I found where we were staying on the beach again, and went inside, and it didn't take me into the underworld or anything, but it was really freaky. And so now I'm kind of like, maybe I don't know everything about the supernatural, because that was really scary. And I couldn't even take a picture of it, because I would have had to use my flash, which would have been light, and it would have made it disappear, and now I sound like a crazy person, but honestly, this was real, and it happened to me.
Well, that would have been the perfect way to exercise it.
I guess. I didn't know what it was trying to do. And anyway, I came back in, and I was really freaked out, and Robert was there, and we had like a discussion about it, because I kind of needed to process the fact that I had seen my first actual supernatural thing.
And so now Robert can admit that it was him.
It sounds like a horner of the dark.
Wait, what? What, Robert? A horner
of the dark if he is light.
Yeah, exactly. Light as an anti-illumination force. It was fascinating.
And now I just gave every person who tunes in and writes like a thing, because I haven't used it. So that's how you know it was real, because I didn't use it in a story, because it freaked me out too hard that I didn't even be like, I have to write right now what I saw. It was like, no, it's like too deep and personal and actually supernatural.
Robert, right. You want to come clean about this now? That you, that was you, wasn't it?
So if we're confessing, I had an experience over New Year's that freaked me out completely. So I spent
Look, Robert loves this shit. He's leaning forward.
I'm getting my Ouija board right now.
Oh my god!
I spent the new long New Year's weekend painting, and we put up a new chandelier and a new ceiling fan. And you know, inevitably, there were parts missing from the boxes. So, you know, whatever, there were parts missing. So after it was all done, I'm sitting there on the couch. And the dog sitting there, and we're all by ourselves because everybody's just going up the stairs, and all of a sudden I hear tunk tunk tunk.
Look,
and there are screws and nuts bouncing across the floor like somebody just dropped them out of the sky. And I was like, what the fuck? And the dog just, you know, gets up and he's like,
uh-uh.
And The dog and I just walked out of the room and went away.
Wow. I love watching Molly's face when you're telling this. I've got her up on the big screen.
It's like that poltergeist moment where things just fall out of the sky.
Yeah.
Somebody was like 3 inches above the floor and just dropped screws and nuts.
That's and fucking freaky.
And it's everything I was missing, right?
Wow.
It's everything I had to pull out of my own stash.
A helpful ghost.
And Mandy's like, you got to go up and check the light fixture, make sure that you just. It's like, no, it didn't fall from there. It fell from way down here. Nobody believes me, but the dog was there.
I believe you. I wouldn't have before September of 2015, but now I do. Now I know.
I believe you too. I mean, there's some numinous shit going on out there.
There is numinous shit.
Seriously.
Yeah. We, I mean,
and it's not like the first thing I've ever seen, but you know, it was the most recent thing and probably the most tangible.
Yeah, and you know, weird things happen. I'm a big believer in just because you don't know the answer to something doesn't mean that you have to make an answer up. If you see something weird, you don't have to go with, well, it's aliens or it's a ghost. Maybe you saw something weird and you have absolutely no idea what it was.
Yeah. It was the alcohol.
Yeah, it could have been the alcohol, too.
I was totally sober, by the way, when this ghost thing happened to me. It was maybe the only time that entire week I was sober, but I was sober for that experience. So I feel like, I don't know, if that makes it more or less valid coming from me. But
did you have a hangover?
No, by that time in the afternoon, probably not. In the evening, no. I hadn't. The one from the previous day had worn off, and I had yet to accrue that day's good times.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds weird, though, Molly. It reminds me of this short film. You guys probably saw it. That came out maybe 2 years ago. You know what I'm talking about, Pete, where this lady's going to bed. And she's alone in her apartment.
Oh, yeah, she turned the light off and, yeah.
Yeah, and she sees a coat rack. She's got, well, there's a coat rack at the end of the hall.
Oh, fuck, and, no.
Yeah, you guys should watch this. It's a free short film on Vimeo or YouTube, I don't remember.
Yeah.
And so when the light's on, it's a coat rack. She turns off the light, and it's this figure. You know, and she keeps turning the light back on and back off. And, yeah, it's pretty weird.
Nope.
Yeah.
I made myself scream the other day because our coat rack is right near the front window and I hadn't closed the blinds for the evening and I saw this horrible giant puffy coat that my husband wears when it's really cold out and it looked like someone was staring in through the window and I was like, ah! And it was like alone in my house and I was pretty glad that nobody saw that moment, but it was a pretty bad one, yeah. But I like to I freak myself out constantly. I still maintain there's nothing scarier than spitting out your toothpaste because like every time in a movie, like you look back up, there's somebody behind you, right? And I cannot brush my teeth without every day of my life, you know, being pretty sure that someone who's coming to murder me is like gonna be right there. So,
God,
sorry. Every single time, every time.
Do you ever in the middle of the night? Do you ever hear a sound in your house, and you think, I'm not going to investigate the sound because I know it's something.
No, the other night I was watching a rerun of Hannibal, and it was one of the freakier episodes of it. And my cat was hanging out on his cat paradise, and he just sort of sat up and like looked towards where the door was, and I was like, I don't care. They can come for me. Like, I don't give a shit. Like, I'm not going to go and look. I'm not going to turn around. Like, whatever is going to happen to me is going to happen to me because my cat is just doing that cat thing where he's like, it's the most important thing in the world, and he's looking at it right there, and I was like, no, mm-mm. I'd rather not know, honestly.
Yeah, he's like, lady, I'm not concerned. I got 9 lives. You got 1.
Yeah.
Now, see, I don't hear sounds at night. I am merely tasked with getting up and investigating them.
Yeah.
So
I will tell you guys that I ran out of my own house once.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Tell me more.
All right, well, so when I was a little kid, my Uncle Robert died, and after that happened, weird things started happening in the house. And there was only one shared bathroom upstairs. And my room was right next to the bathroom. And I would hear people go into the bathroom. And I would sit there and go, okay, when they get out, I'll get out. And of course, hours later, they're still not out. And, you know, it's like, okay. So I get up and door shut, the lights on, nobody's in there. And, you know, this went on for years. And when I was a teen, I came home one day, and it was winter. It wasn't cold. It was probably October, November. And I go into the house, and I'm all alone, and I can hear the whole house is whispering. Like, I run out of the house, and just as I get outside, I'm standing there in the driveway, my mom pulls in, she's like, what's wrong? And I'm like, nothing's wrong. She says, well, come on in inside. It's like, no, no.
Oh my
and
God.
It's like, I finally told him about it. He says, oh, it's just the hot water heater, because we still had radiators, and it's the water running through the radiator.
He was in cahoots.
And I'm like, bullshit. You know, I know what the radiator sounds like. But yeah, that's like the scariest thing that I can remember.
That's freaky.
There were other weird things. But, you know, my grandmother worked for this place called the General Lafayette Inn outside Philadelphia, and it was supposedly haunted. And every once in a while, she would come home with stories about when she was closing up and, you know, things were gone. But yeah.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, I know.
I don't like that one bit. Mm.
So when I went to school in Florida Tech, and they had this huge botanical garden, and you know, on Saturday nights at midnight, we'd all meet in this place called High Pagoda, which is on a hill in the middle of the pavilion in the jungle, and we get drunk, right? So I get there late, and everybody's looking at me like, what the hell? And I'm like, so what? He said, Pete, you left an hour before us. And you're just, and it's like, well, I just came up this way. And like, well, you can't have come that way. The bridge is out. They took it down to repair it. I said, no, I just came across it. So they marched me back there, and there's no bridge over the swamp.
What?
Yeah. It's
yeah.
Just
like, yeah, you told me that story before. That's a great story.
All of them, the death row.
Yeah, it's just like, and it's like everybody's looking at my feet to see, like, you know, if I got mud or stuff, and I'm clean. You know, like, yeah, okay.
That's all right, let's see. Like let's some... I don't like that.
So, anyway, they didn't like me anyway because I was, like, all Cthulhu-y.
So, Robert, let's talk about coincidence, because I hear you have a great story about coincidence. Something about a stolen paperweight.
And maybe, all right. Well, I do have a story.
Yeah, I'm fascinated by this too, so that's why I want everyone to hear this.
Okay. I also have a really spooky story. This is not a spooky story.
Go right ahead.
But I'm actually writing something right now about coincidence magic, which is not related to this story per se, but my sister and I used to have a New Year's party every year when I was younger, and for years and years and years. And then one year when I was, I guess, about 22, we had about 100 people crash. This was at my parents' house. And the place got kind of trashed, and we had a... the big stolen item was this paperweight that my parents had. Right by the front door, that was very special to them, and someone took it on their way out. And it was just generally a disaster, and we decided the next year that we weren't going to have a party. We're going to take a year off. The last one was so bad. And that night, I went out on New Year's Eve for the very first time in my life, and that was the night I met my husband. Just going out because my parents' house was trashed the year before. And if my parents' house wasn't trashed the year before, we would have had a party, and I would never have met my husband. So with, 18 years later. I'm always really interested in what is coincidence, what is fate, how our lives are formed by the random events. It's endlessly fascinating to me. So that's the story of the paperweight.
Okay, then, and you're writing a story?
I'm working on something about, you know, where coincidence comes from. So.
All right, so that I've got a great story for you then. This is a true story. So there's this young man one time, and he was working as a delivery driver at a pizza place. So this friend of his comes in the pizza place, and that he hasn't seen in years. And grew up with him, but he hasn't seen him in years. And he said, "Hey, I heard you were working here. I'm gonna go bowling tonight. You feel like going bowling?" And it's me, by the way. So I said, "Yeah, why not? Let's go bowling." Now, the first thing that happened was I was supposed to close the pizza place that night. In other words, work real late until the shop closed. If I'd have had to do that, I would not have been able to go bowling. That's the first thing. So I traded shifts with another guy that was working there that night. You know, he could have said no quite easily. And so I left a few minutes later with him and we went bowling. It was this midnight rockin' bowl thing in Iowa. Kind of weird thing where they play loud rock music and everybody bowls. And so I'm bowling with a couple of friends, and this girl and her friends were in the next lane. And she starts talking to me, and it's Danielle, of course, and the story is later that she had not been bowling in years either. Some friends of hers had talked her into going bowling because they said she was in law school at the time and working too much at a part-time job at, I think it was JCPenney or something like that, and at the local mall. And so they wanted her to have a night out and go bowling. So if they hadn't been able to talk her into it, if that the guy I worked with hadn't traded shifts with me, and she could have easily been, there's like 25 bowling lanes in that place. She could have easily been at the far end of the room.
Aww.
You know. So, you know, a lot of things.
The really freaky thing is, of course, all the things that you don't find out about, all the businesses that you miss. You know, you can sort of like make this sort of association and about this wouldn't have happened if this happened, but who didn't we see because our backs were turned? Who didn't we run into? What disaster did we avoid? That's fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah, very true. And I mean, it goes even further. I had just gotten my hair cut earlier that day, and my hair at the time was like down to here.
Oh my gosh! And,
oh yeah, I was like 23,
hey.
This was the early 1900s or so. And
you had the ribbon tied in the back.
No, I did not. I did not. But I just got my hair cut to basically the length it is now, and you know, years later, Danielle told me, she said, "You got your hair cut. I would never have talked to you.
You're having ribbons in your hair, Molly. I used to wear pigtails back in the day."
Well, she said, "I would never have come up to you if your hair had been long and talked to you."
Oh, my God.
So there's just so many dominoes that had to be lined up just perfectly for us to meet.
The universe wanted it to happen.
Yeah, well, of course, now there's this beautiful 13-year-old boy that exists because of that chain of coincidence. So, long story short, it fascinates me too, Robert. So,
yeah, it's amazing. Our entire lives are built by these very minuscule chain of events. It's bizarre.
Yeah, I had been a manager at a bagel place until about 6 months previously. I basically decided, it's just me. This is too much responsibility. I'm just going to go deliver pizzas. I have no debt. So I'm going to work like 25 hours a week, deliver pizzas. That'll pay my rent. That's it. Which is exactly what I did. But because of that decision, too, I was at the pizza place that night. You know, so
it's funny. It kind of goes back to this concept of Lovecraft and cosmic horror about our insignificance. We're also made up of these moments of insignificance.
that's important.
Somehow join together to create lives, you know, biologically, you know, emotionally. It's we're made of such ephemera.
Luminous creatures are we.
And life itself, you know, billions of years ago. So, you said you had a spooky story too.
I do.
Okay.
Molly, I might have told Molly this when we were in South Carolina, but.
Oh yeah, it's a good one.
This happened last year, about a year ago when my son was sick. And we were walking through the park, stopped and stared up at this big tree that's in the middle of our very urban park. It's like a city block wide. And he said, there's a airplane up in that tree, 6 years old. But, you know, I looked up at where he was looking, and I said, oh, okay. And he said, no, it's not an airplane. It's a balloon. It's a blue balloon. Okay, it's a blue balloon. I look over at this other part of the park, and there's a children's birthday party there with all of these multicolored balloons. One of the balloons unmoors itself from the table with no one touching it, floats across the park, and lodges itself in the tree exactly where my son was looking.
Oh, wow.
The balloon.
That's awesome.
And I couldn't believe what had happened. And I tried to explain it away to myself. I thought maybe it had happened to another identically colored balloon out of all of these multicolored balloons. And I didn't see it, and I didn't see it. But then he wouldn't have said that he thought it was an airplane first. So I go figure.
Yeah.
It made no sense.
So many weird stories.
That's that one.
Well, so I guess before we're done interviewing you here, I'd like to know, who are some of your favorite authors, you know, past authors and authors who are working today?
Well, definitely the aforementioned Elizabeth Hand and Laird Barron, who are, you know, I'm a huge fan of both of them. I mentioned Caitlin Kiernan before. I mean, you know, and on the one hand, I could rattle off 100, but I think my literary touchstone is definitely Elizabeth Hand, and the reason why, among many, including the fact that she's an incredible stylist, is that to her detriment as a career author, she will write anything. She writes horror, science fiction, fantasy, noir. I mean, right now she has this incredible series, the Castanieri mystery series that she's writing.
Wilding Hall, man.
What's that?
Wilding Hall.
Wilding Hall is incredible.
It was one of the best things I read last year, absolutely.
She can write anything. I think from a marketing perspective, that's you know, as she will admit, it's like, which is unfortunate. I love authors that can do that. I wish everyone celebrated them. I don't want to write one thing. I don't. And I know you understand that, Molly. You write all sorts of different things as well. But she's definitely my number one touchstone, because she can do it all. And I want to, you know, I would love to write a gothic romance. I would love to write some, you know, neo-noir piece. Or right now, I definitely feel at home in a dark fantasy horror lane. But, you know, I admire someone who can do everything so well.
Yeah, it seems like some of the most financially successful authors, emphasis on financially, are those who do exactly one thing. You know, like I mentioned frequently on the show that I like the Jack Reacher series by Lee Child. That's pretty much all he writes.
Right.
You know, and I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with that, but when you diversify, there's a financial challenge there.
There really is. It's unfortunate. It's just part of the machine of modern publishing in a lot of ways. And, you know, again, it goes back to that thing of how much do readers like to play size. I don't have an answer for that. But, you know, I like people who are... I'll read almost anything that isn't... I find a lot of contemporary fantasy to be dreadfully boring because everything is from a perspective of a very simplistic, heroic point of view, and that doesn't interest me at all. It's true, it happens a lot. It happens primarily in fantasy and science fiction, as far as I'm concerned, where you have this protagonist who is very cookie cutter, very, you know, for lack of a better word, very Mary Sue. And it's just, it forced me to tears. I want people, you know, I like damaged people. I like people who write on the edge, people like Caitlin Kiernan. I love Livy Llewellyn, who I'm very fortunate to know. Gemma Files, I love. And you know, a lot of authors that aren't in our neck of the woods, like Jennifer Egan, I adore. Dan Shaun, who wrote this amazing book called Await Your Reply, that if you haven't read, you should really read. Which, interestingly enough, has a lot of straight-up heavy Lovecraft references. I would definitely check that one out. That's the title, Await Your Reply, is from a spam he got. That was the subject line, Await Your Reply. And he wrote this whole book basically out of that, and it's about scammers. And it's told from multiple perspectives, and it's brilliant. That's my big suggestion of the night, Await Your Reply, Dan Shaun. Read it.
I find writers that I'm really attracted to, especially nowadays, read a lot outside the box, and I'm assuming you read outside the box. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. It's a struggle, you know, I've definitely reached a point in my life where reading is a very complicated activity for me. I feel like I don't want to speak for other writers. For me, I feel like I'm a writer because I'm a reader. I'm a born reader. And writing has complicated my relationship with reading, and has not for the better, to be honest. Being a writer now has made my reading life less enjoyable, both because it's very difficult for me to engage with texts not as a writer, and I wish I could wave a magic wand and just be a reader again without that baggage. And I feel like I know so many writers now, and I feel a responsibility to read all of them. And there's a lot of pressure there. And sometimes I just want to, you know, knock my entire to read pile aside and, you know, go read Jane Eyre, which I've never read. I've never read Jane Eyre. Don't read Jane Eyre?
We can talk later. I went back to it because I was like, I love this stuff. I love Jane Eyre. And I was like, wow, this book is actually really long. And
I know, but isn't it too long because we've been on the internet for this number of years?
No. No, it's just too long. And I reread. I mean, I reread Jane Austen every year. I'm not a huge Bronte's girl. Like, I'm a Jane Austen girl. And in that knife fight of Bronte's versus Austen, I'm on the Austen side. So. Well,
Wuthering Heights is like my fave. So I
didn't know we could have like. I like Wuthering Heights better than Jane Eyre. Jane Eyre is just like, he's not even hot. Chill. Like, he literally locked up a woman. Like, is he a catch? No. Do we need 700 pages about this? Like,
I'm not going to throw Ethan Frome into this at all. So.
I have read Ethan Frome.
I haven't. No friends in here.
Equal to Ethan Frome for an English class.
Wow.
Yeah, that's what I read it for.
I've never been fromed.
Well, so the next time you come to Florida, I'll frome you.
Oh, I don't know what that means. I don't know either,
but it sounds good, right?
Now this thing gets me. Okay, cool.
I like Jane Eyre, but I can't stand Thomas Hardy.
Oh, that's some boring shit.
I mean, to answer Joe's question...
Before you diss Thomas Hardy, read his poetry.
Poetry.
Okay. His poetry. Really poetry. He may be an excellent poet.
I will agree with Molly that I think locking up women is that's just wrong. So
let's come down firmly on the side of that. I like that.
I'm going to go out on a limb. Yeah. I don't care who disagrees with me on that.
Yeah.
So, but you're saying, Robert, you would like to just, hey, I want to read for enjoyment, no other reason, no response, no. Is that what you're saying?
You know, it's just so much reading as a writer. I found, speaking for myself, is feels like research, and I can't remember the last thing that I read that didn't feel that way. Maybe I'm just in a curmudgeonly place.
No,
but that's one of the beauties of. All right, you mentioned Liz Hand when Generation Lost came out. What was that? 2009, maybe now.
You know, it's funny. I've thought a lot about. It was the first book of hers I read, and
it wasn't mine at all. But I just thought it was brilliant. And when you come across something like that, when you come across Laird's first collection, Livy, Engines of Desire, A Pretty Mouth, another great example, and I could list another. I don't know, 20, 25, and. In the last 5 or 6 years, I agree with you that I started as a reader. I would like to go back to just being that reader. But it's one of the beauties that when you come across Engines of Desire or one of Laird's collections or Generation Loss or your book, that's one of the reasons. The two highlights for me, novel-wise, last year was A Glittering World and Gemma's experimental film. There's enough power and beauty in the work where I got to read again. You know, it was just Joe Pulver reading. I didn't have my writer's hat on. I didn't have my editor's hat on. It's like... And that's a wonderful thing, and I really treasure material like that when I come across it these days. Because it is so difficult to remove yourself as a craftsman when you're engaged in work nowadays.
Joe, you're absolutely right. Thank you for removing me from my K-hole of shame, and now I feel more positive.
Aww.
You're absolutely right. That's actually how I felt when I read every single one of those things you just said. So thank you for reminding me of that. And you just need to find those things that remind you of being a reader and being a grateful reader.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more.
Y'all, I'm sorry. I hate this one, but I got a motor.
Okay. Thanks for being on the show, Molly.
No, it was super. It was a pleasure. It's been too long. And bye, Molly. All of you. Bye. Yay. All right. I'll see you later.
Bye.
Before we go, Robert, any advice for? Would you happen to have any advice for writers who haven't been published yet or beginning writers?
I'll try to keep it to 50 words or less, but there's some really shop-worn advice that is excellent advice, and I can't stress it enough, which is write the book or the story or whatever you're writing that you want to read that has not been written yet. There's no better advice that anyone will ever give you, because whatever happens to that work, you will have at least one reader who is grateful, and that is yourself. And I know that might not sound so inspiring, but it is the best advice anyone has ever given me, ever. So there you go.
Awesome. Anyone else have any questions for Robert before we let him go? No? Well, thanks for being on, Robert. Really appreciate you.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a blast.
So, I think we're going to talk a few more minutes. You're welcome to hang around or go, whatever you want to do.
So. I'm going to go because I have to put my kids to sleep.
Okay.
But thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for being on the show, and have a great night.
It was great seeing you.
Bye, guys. Thank you.
All you got to do is close your browser there, and it'll kick you out. So.
I'll do it. Bye, guys.
Thanks, Trevor.
Thank you.
So, yeah, if anyone listening, you haven't read The Glittering World, definitely pick it up. And what was I going to talk? Oh, so Cloverfield 2?
Yeah, secret movie. Apparently. Number 10, Cloverfield Lane.
Can I just comment? Do you ever watch my very favorite version of The Three Musketeers? Is the one from 1974 and 1975. It has Hal Welch, Oliver Reed, Carlton Heston. It's brilliant. There's never been a better one, with thrilling swordplay and beautiful costumes and a great script. When the director made it, it was all filmed as one movie.
It's two movies.
When he released it as two movies. So the stars were only paid once. And for years, it was tied up in litigation over that fact that they got paid for one movie, one long movie, and he released it as two separate movies. And it only recently became available to stream or watch or on DVD or whatever. Like 40 years after the fact.
Oh, I was trying to figure out the segue. It was us talking about streaming the segue?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Did you ever see the third movie he made, The Fifth Musketeer?
No, I always thought of The Man in the Iron Mask as The Fifth Musketeer.
I think it was called The Five Musketeers. He got the cast to get. What happened was there was an actor in the original two movies named Roy Kinnear, who was actually the father of the actor who plays the Frankenstein monster in Penny Dreadful. And he was a comedian. He was in Help as the mad scientist's assistant. And he was also D'Artagnan's assistant in this movie. What happened? He died during a horse riding incident in The Five Musketeers. So that basically doomed the distribution of the movie. It ended up until it never got released because that was a big... I don't know, scandal might not be the right word, but controversy. Sort of like what happened when Vic Morrow died in The Twilight Zone. But there was a sequel, and they somehow brought Christopher Lee back, even though he really should be dead.
Well, so is 10 Cloverfield Lane a sequel to Cloverfield?
Apparently it is.
Well... it's a great trailer, because at the beginning of the trailer, you're like, oh, what a nice family film. This family's sitting around playing games and having fun, you know? But on IMDb, the synopsis reads, waking up from a car accident, a young woman finds herself in the basement of a man who says he saved her life from a chemical attack that has left the outside uninhabitable. So... or a monster attack, one or the other, you know, same thing. So, but man, this whole thing was a big secret.
Yep. Apparently it was.
How in the hell did he do that?
Apparently they had a code name for the film and everything.
When is that coming out?
Like
March 11th.
Yeah.
So,
by the way, there's a new H.P. Lovecraft Historical Society CD.
Oh, what is it?
It's a Christmas special, a solstice carol. It is a sort of variation on a Christmas carol, and it adapts the festival's Pickman's model and The Outsider. So it's an unusual piece of adaptation. Lovecraft right. gets visited by four ghosts.
Oh, wow. I don't think I've heard about this at all. That's interesting.
I was just checking if they came out with something. So it obviously had a Christmas release.
Yeah. Hmm. Okay. All right, any other news we need to talk about before we go?
Just to show you my favorite Cthulhu Wars expansion figure. This is Lovecraft. It's a first player marker. They had a...
the one where he's holding the lantern, yeah.
And what's nice, now if you look at the base, you see water here. So it looks like he's on the beach. And originally this was supposed to be a rock. But if you look behind here, you can see that the rock has an eye. It's a Shuggoth.
When did the expansion arrive?
Monday. But that was an exclusive. They had two first player figures, which are just first player markers. They don't have attributes. The other one is Atheneth Waite. She looks like some high priestess wearing horns, and I guess that's supposed to be a Shuggoth behind her. Those are no longer going to be available. At least they're not part of the second onslaught. They were put out as exclusives.
Hmm.
So if you missed out on them, and maybe, hopefully, I think I would like to see them reissue because some more people can get them with their excellent figures. But it may be a while if they ever re-release them.
All right. Well, guys, thanks for being on the show. If you want, again, we're giving away, Matt's got a copy of The Glittering World, and then Pete has copies, one copy each. Of what I'm about to list. Crypt of Cthulhu, H.P. Lovecraft's Nightmare Country, and The Lurking Chronology by Pete Rolick, which is a timeline of August Derleth stories, Lovecraftian stories, right?
So, right.
So if you want one of those four books, just send an email to the Lovecraft eZine Prizes email address, which is Lovecraft eZine. prizes@gmail.com. It's Lovecraft, EZINEPRIZES @gmail. And please put in the subject of the email, please put the book that you would like to go for. And anything you want in the body of the email. So, and I'll do that drawing next weekend. So anyway, thanks for watching, thanks for listening, and thanks guys for being on the show.
Yep.